On behalf of the American Heart Association, I would like to welcome you to this session, HCM, a primary form of heart failure. To access live closed caption, please click on the closed caption button found on your screen. All sessions will be recorded and available in the coming weeks. It is my pleasure to welcome our speaker for today's session, Dr. Richard Wright, who is currently chairman of the board at Pacific Heart Institute, Santa Monica in California. As a reminder, full speaker bios can be found in the event lobby. Dr. Wright, the floor is yours.
Well, thanks very much, Bianca. What I want to do in the minutes allocated to me is talk about hypertrophic cardiomyopathy from the heart failure specialist perspective. That's what I do. I'm a heart failure doctor. And I'm going to spin a story that the more important aspect of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy is not the contraction phase of the heart, or systole, as we call it. I'm going to try to convince you that the relaxation phase, the half of the heart cycle when the heart is relaxing and accepting blood, is equally important and needs attention as a doctor taking care of patients with hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. And hence, we're going to spin this as hypertrophic cardiomyopathy being an example of what we would term preserved ejection fraction heart failure, in which somebody's heart is struggling, but the main reason that they're symptomatic is the heart is struggling during its relaxation phase. These are my disclosures, and several of these companies make products that can be used in individuals with hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. So first, let me define what heart failure is. When I was a co-author of the heart failure guidelines, we literally spent 6 months trying to define what heart failure is. But a few important points. First is, it's a syndrome, not a disease. So think about fever. Fever is a syndrome. It's not a disease. It's caused by many things. But heart failure is exemplified by a condition in which the heart doesn't do its job. The job of the heart is to propel blood to the body at an acceptable pressure without flooding the body, and particularly the lungs, because that's what makes people short of breath in this condition. Now, clinically, we define this with signs and symptoms. Most commonly, this is, as you'll see in a minute here, intolerance to exercise. Usually there's some objective finding. In this day and age, we often use echocardiograms, and we also rely on blood tests, typically biomarkers, and the most important one in the heart failure community is listed there is the NT-proBNP, a blood marker in which when the heart's unhappy, it releases this into the bloodstream. And many things cause this scenario, right? Everything from high blood pressure to prior heart attacks, bad heart valves, but we're going to focus on one of the causes, which the one listed in the center, in which typically there's a genetic or maybe a post-genetic abnormality of protein expression in the heart that leads to this phenotype, as we call it, or clinical condition of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. Now, if you have this syndrome of heart failure, there are two basic categories you can put together to cause this heart failure syndrome. One, which represents about half of such patients, would be a situation in which the heart is weak. It just doesn't pump very well. The second, though, would be that the heart doesn't fill very well. And hypertrophic cardiomyopathy is principally a condition in which the heart filling is abnormal, and we'll show you that here in a minute. If you have impaired filling, the heart doesn't fill normally, partly because it's too stiff, and partly it doesn't have the normal suction. When your heart, if you have a normal heart, relaxes, it actually sucks blood into the chamber to prime the pump for the upcoming heartbeat. Now, if you have either of these, a weak heart or a heart that doesn't relax normally, these are the symptoms that typically would present to my patients in our heart failure program. Shortness of breath being, of course, a very common one, but sometimes the person just expresses as they're slowing down, they can't do what they used to do, they do it at half speed, maybe they get short of breath bending over to tie their shoes or to pick something up off the floor. And sometimes, but not all of the time, this is accompanied by things like edema in the legs, and weight changes as well, but it's principally exercise intolerance, and that's the usual symptom of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. And these symptoms listed here, the breathlessness, the exercise intolerance, are not principally related to the gradient the pressure difference between the heart's pumping and the blood vessels, it's usually related to elevations of the pressures within the heart that back up into the lungs that cause the lungs to become flooded. So depicted in these cartoons, this is what a heart might look like if it were weak. It's stretched out, it's dilated, it doesn't have much vigor. Think about somebody whose arms are weak and they just can't lift very much weight. That's different than the typical hypertrophic cardiomyopathy patient, in whom the heart looks more like this, in which the heart is much thicker than normal, hence stiff. Think about a balloon you're trying to inflate. If the rubber of the balloon is very thick, it's going to be hard to inflate that balloon. And hence these hearts, often the pressure backs up into the receiving chambers of the heart. Usually that means the receiving chamber receiving blood from the lungs. So that's the principal physiologic problem with hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. So here's a cartoon depicting this, and this is a standard picture in which the heart muscle is thicker than normal, often twice the normal thickness. That encroaches on the heart, so there's less room for blood to enter the heart, and that's listed here as a small left ventricle. And of course, there are many forms of this depicted in these particular pictures. Many people, the second from the left picture, which is the reverse curve HCM listed there, these people often have a genetic abnormality, and it may be found in younger individuals. The other forms often are older individuals. I've had hypertrophic cardiomyopathy patients that were over 100 years old, where they didn't have this disease appear until their 70s, and then they lived for many years with forms of heart failure. All of these have impaired relaxation, and that gives us an opportunity maybe to make these patients feel better. So what is the fundamental defect? This is a cartoon showing the contraction of muscles. In this case, it's heart muscle, and your heart contracts because there are filaments that slide. Every second when your heart beats, these filaments slide against each other. And if too many of these little heads that connect the sliding fibers are activated, then the heart will be too contractile. That's so-called ejection fraction being high. But if there are too many of these, it also impedes the relaxation of the heart, hence the heart being stiffer and the pressures being higher. And this is depicted by echocardiograms. In the upper left, where VS is ventricular septum, the septum is much too thick. Your septum hopefully is below 1 or 1.2 centimeters. Many of these individuals have 2 centimeter or greater thickness, and that can lead to alterations in blood flow out of the ventricle, as depicted in the lower right, where we use echocardiography to define gradients, as they call it, outside of the left ventricular chamber. But lost in many of these are the hemodynamics of between heartbeats, of diastole, as we call it. So if you look at the, and having spent years putting tubes into people's hearts and measuring these, in the lower part of this diagram, red is the pressure within the heart pumping chamber, the left ventricle. In yellow, just below the red here, is the pressure that you would measure in the arm or the aorta, such as with a blood pressure cuff. And the difference between the red and the yellow there is the so-called gradient. And in this particular depiction, the people focused on the LVOT, left ventricular outflow tract gradient, as being emblematic of the problem with hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. But often lost in this is the concept that the filling pressures, here you can see the LVOT gradient, this is with exercise, is dramatic, so that the person's pressure is very, very high inside the heart and less so in the aorta. But often lost in this is the idea that here in this green on the bottom, that the pressures between the heartbeat, the so-called diastolic pressures, are very high. Your heart, if it's normal, will have a pressure between relaxation or between the beats of anywhere from 0 to 12 millimeters of mercury. In this particular individual depicted with hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, the pressure is 45 millimeters of mercury between beats. And that's so high, the pressure will lead to flooding of the lungs and a sensation of breathlessness. And it's this symptom that is the principal symptom that people complain about with hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. They usually don't come in and complain that they have a 50 millimeter gradient when their heart's pumping. What they come in and say is, I can't breathe and I can't do my normal activities. And that's principally related to this elevated end diastolic pressure. These diastolic pressures, as depicted here in the lower one, are quite variable. Sometimes, for example, normal at rest, but then during exercise and immediately after exercise, very high. That's what this particular one shows. And this can explain why a finding can be normal at rest, but as soon as you exert yourself and you have adrenaline circulating, the heart will manifest these abnormalities that we see with hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, with very high filling pressures translating into breathlessness. And why is that important? Because breathlessness and exercise capacity have historically been used as markers not only of the severity of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, but also of our success at treatment. So here, a common drug used in hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, the beta blocker metoprolol. And if you look at the lower right, in randomized trials, and this is a depiction of the largest randomized beta blocker trial in history, 29 patients, 12 weeks, not a very big trial, but this is the largest trial. And if you look in the lower right, exercise capacity was measured, and metoprolol, with all its beneficial features, did not improve exercise capacity. And the reason for this is, even though it slows the heart, it doesn't improve relaxation of the heart. And that leads to the problem of exercise not improving. So in the lower right, yes, metoprolol reduced the heart rate. The concept being, if you reduce heart rate, you have a longer time to relax, and maybe that will improve things. It does reduce the LV outflow tract gradient, but why doesn't it make exercise better? Because it doesn't change the pulmonary capillary wedge pressure, so-called, which is the filling pressure between heartbeats. And that's depicted with the right heart cath on the right side of this, in which these people had catheters put in and measured, and there is no improvement in diastolic performance in patients with hypertrophic cardiomyopathy when you give them metoprolol. Now, I wanted to find out whether this was in fact known before. So I went back to the original literature in the 1960s. Here, for example, is a cath lab study in which catheters are put into the person and they're given a beta blocker propranolol, which is still used. And what they showed was propranolol could reduce the gradient, but if they looked carefully, it showed that it didn't actually change diastolic pressure and hence no improvement in exercise. Now, this is different than other drugs that can be used. There are two myosin inhibitors, one approved and one perhaps soon to be approved. And these are medicines which directly improve the relaxation of the heart by avoiding some of this excess contraction. And this is, although not measured in the cath lab, this slide asks the question, is the heart happier? You look on the right, the NT-proBNP, that's the hormone released by hearts when they're stretched out, goes down dramatically, strongly indicating that the left ventricle is relaxing more appropriately with this particular medicine, in this case, mavacamten. And indeed, if you measure this with echo indirectly, this is another way of measuring it, improved ventricular diastolic function in this particular trial. Yes, the gradient goes down, but diastolic function improves. In green is diastolic performance that's reasonable. In red, it's bad. And when you give individuals this drug, it turns out that these echo findings strongly suggest that there's improvement in cardiac relaxation. So I want to take you back to the original monograph to show you that this is not a new idea. So this was the original publication that I owned from Gene Braunwald, and Gene was my mentor, in which they coined hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, idiopathic hypertrophic subaortic stenosis. This is from 1964. This monograph represented half of all the known cases in the world at that time of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. Different than what I see today, because the patients in this study were ages 6 to 56, but the average was age 21. So younger people than I see typically with HCM or hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. But I want to point out a few things. If you look on where it says dyspnea on the upper part of this graph, and each of these dots is a particular patient, and left to right is the gradient measured in the cath lab, not by echo, because they didn't have echo in 1964. And what you see is shortness of breath had no relation, zero, with the left ventricular outflow gradient. You could have a gradient of 20 or a gradient of 120, and it made no difference in terms of whether you were symptomatic with breathlessness. There was no correlation whatsoever. The correlation was with diastolic pressure, here listed as left ventricular and diastolic pressure. The green vertical bar represents anybody to the left is normal, anybody to the right is abnormal. And virtually all the people who were short of breath at rest had an elevated left ventricular and diastolic pressure. So even back in 1964, the connection between shortness of breath was what your filling pressure was, not what your gradient was. And indeed, this was shown even when they gave maneuvers. We've talked about, and we will talk more today about maneuvers, but you can alter the gradient and many times the left ventricular diastolic pressure by doing things. Here, for example, Dr. Braunwald gave nitroglycerin on the right versus no nitro on the left in hopes of eliciting a gradient, which he did. But in these maneuvers, the diastolic pressure often would get worse, not better. Here, for example, raising the legs on the lower half of this made the left ventricular diastolic pressure go from 20 to 45, which is why many of these patients get shorter breath with such types of maneuvers, because blood is shifted to the lungs during these scenarios. So here you see a dramatic increase just with this simple maneuver of raising the legs in the cardiac cath lab. So what I want to leave you with is just the concept. Don't forget the relaxation phase or diastole of the heart. That's where the action is in terms of symptom relief. The heart on the right, the hypertrophic heart that's thick, will always have an elevated diastolic pressure during exercise or during stress or emotional moments. You can improve that, but the way to improve that is to improve relaxation. And I thank you for your time and look forward to your questions. Thanks much. Well,
thank you, Dr. Wright, for your presentation, and thank you to our audience for your participation. Coming up next at 1:05 p.m. Central, we will have Approaches to Community Engagement and Collaboration. To access that session, please exit this session and return to the lobby using the menu at the top of your screen. From the lobby, click on the Sessions tab first, then click on the individual session to join. Thank you very much for attending today's HCM Connection Forum. We'll see you shortly.